Good afternoon. I'm Kathy Morris. I am the current senior curator here at the Clark and the Sylvia and Leonard Marks Director of Collections and Exhibitions, and I am very pleased to see you all here on this sunny Berkshire's afternoon. Thank you very much for coming and for helping us inaugurate our exciting summer exhibition, Splendor, Myth, and Vision, Nudes from the Prado. So this is the first day of the exhibition's opening, and I have the pleasure and the privilege to introduce our speakers this morning. This was as you'll hear, this is a project that was a long time in the making, and I'm proud to have been part of the curatorial team to put this exhibition together, along with my colleagues who I will just introduce in a moment, as well as a few others who are not with us today. Because we have three speakers, I'm not going to spend a lot of time myself. I'm just going to say again thank you and let you know that next Sunday, a week from tomorrow, we have another lecture related to this exhibition I want to be sure that you're aware of. One of the catalog essay authors, Jill Burke, from the University of Edinburgh, I'm going to read the name of her a lecture next Sunday, June 19th at 3 p.m., Nudity and Nakedness in Renaissance Europe. So who wouldn't want to come to that? But this morning, or this afternoon, we have three speakers who will follow each other in succession, and then we'll open it up to conversation and questions from the floor. So we have my former colleague, Tom Lohman, who until recently was Associate Deputy Director here at the Clark and is now the Director and CEO of the Wadsworth Athenaeum. My colleague, Lara Yeager-Crisselt, Curator of Paintings and Sculptures here at the Clark, and Miguel Falomir Faust, the Deputy Director for Collections and Research at the Museo Nacional del Prado in Madrid. So welcome, and we look forward to your comments.
Maybe I don't need it. I don't know. Maybe Kathy will hand me hers. Miguel, maybe I'll take yours.
This better?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm Tom Lohman, and I guess I get to go first because I'm the old dog on this project. I want to start with putting a little context to it all. I'm reading a marvelous book called The Vanishing Velázquez that some of you may have seen the review a few weeks ago in the journal on the weekend. And because I have this new job, I actually don't get very much read. Once I do my homework, I maybe get through a page and a half, and then I wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning with a book in my lap. But I've just come to the part where she's describing the Spanish match, which happened in 1623. The Prince of Wales, Charles, the son of James the First of England, the Scotsman, James of the King James Bible, he had an intention to marry his son to the sister, the little sister, of Philip the Fourth of Spain. And there actually had been a betrothal contract written up earlier in the 17th century that committed Charles's elder brother to marry her, but of course he died, and Charles, with the Duke of Buckingham, under assumed names, crossed the channel, went through France as Mr. Johnson and Mr. Smith, and they showed up in Madrid and said, ta-da, we're here. And apparently the Duke of Buckingham was so obnoxious that he brought prostitutes to the Alcazar and all kinds of awful things. And I just want to begin by saying I hope that the Clark delegation didn't do likewise when we stumbled into Madrid so many years ago. And in fact, I think we made a good match. When we first began our conversation with the Museo Nacional del Prado, it was 2008. Which might seem like forever ago. That might be the year that we're all trying to forget when we think about our retirement accounts. But in fact, there was a real logical context to our collaboration. Now, Miguel Zugasa, Miguel Falamir's boss, the director of the Prado, had come to the Berkshires some years earlier at the invitation of Carmen Jimenez, and they had toured the area. They had met everyone here at the Clark, met everyone at Massmocha, and he knew at that point that the Clark could be a really amazing institution to collaborate with, and he had the perfect reason to activate that collaboration. In 2008, the Prado had just unveiled its new expansion by Rafael Moneo. It is a grand space, a really large space, with new exhibition rooms and visitor amenities, mostly built underground to the east of the Prado. And so here you see a view of the lobby as it appeared that year. And they began doing a different character of show at the Prado. I love the Prado, and the Prado have been great colleagues to collaborate with. But back in the 1990s, shows at the Prado were often monographic. They were often telling the story of Spain. They were grand in scale, and they were produced in the Grand Gallery often, the largest of them. Well, this space allowed them to do a different kind of show and to think about their exhibition program differently. In fact, it was that autumn that they mounted a major show about Rembrandt as a history painter. And that's not heretofore what you would have thought of the Prado as doing. They own, I believe, one painting by Rembrandt. I mean, it's, yeah, just one. So they did a very smart show around that. And in that year, this institution had just completed construction of the Stonehill Center, and we still had an exhibition space in the Manton Research Center of somewhat smaller rooms, but we were getting ready to build the very structure we sit in today. And so the marvelous show, maybe some of you will remember, that summer was about Whistler and Innes and the art of painting softly, kind of like the weather today. The weather is painting softly. So off we went. Looking at what kinds of projects would make sense for each other's institutions. And for us, we actually looked at three very different concepts that would drive at what the heart of the Prado collections could speak to the world. And all of which would have been major digressions from, at that point, what had become a wonderful rhythm here at the Clark of presenting 19th century French art and 19th century British art and 19th century American art. And so indeed, we settled on a marvelous coincidence of history that in Madrid, there had been this passion for collecting the nude and indeed commissioning some of the most lascivious paintings in the history of art. Yet these paintings had been isolated and locked up and kept away. And this phenomenon of the Sala Reservada, and particularly the Sala Reservada and the Royal Collections, had been the subject of study of our great colleague Javier Portus, who's the keeper for Spanish painting at the Prado, with a monograph that he had published in 1998. So we knew that there was an interesting story, a story that was about museum display. When the Prado first opened, it had a Sala Reservada. It was a story about the history of art, and it was a story that the public might be curious about here in America. And so we made a decision in the autumn of 2009, together with our colleagues at the Prado, particularly Gabriele Finaldi, Miguel's predecessor as Deputy Director for Collections and Research, and Miguel Zugasa, Richard Rand, Michael Conforti, and myself. And I don't know why the screen's doing that, but that's interesting. Now, the other question was, what kind of show would come from Williamstown and go to Madrid? And we had long had in our mind a global tour of highlights of our collection to take place during the time of construction and closure of the museum building here in Williamstown. And so we all thought we would be doing a kind of a survey of French art. But in the end, the leadership of the Prado came to us with a rather Fabulous idea. Would it be possible for us to lend all our Renoirs? And we thought, oh my, that's an interesting idea. And they explained the situation. How could the Prado tell a Prado-like story based on the Clark's collections? The Prado has such profundity in its holdings. There are more paintings by Titian at the Prado than any other place in the world. There are more paintings by Rubens at the Prado than any other place in the world. And so the decision was made not to do the survey show, but rather this comprehensive look at the mid-career of Renoir through the Clark's collection, and to present it in the main halls in the old building, the Villanueva building, at the Prado, so that you could have an intense experience looking at Renoir and then step into the next room and have an intense experience looking at Murillo, and then walk next door and have an intense experience looking at Velázquez. And the result was quite marvelous. Here you see the opening weekend of Passion por Renoir, which opened in October of 2010. And I'll just go quickly through. It was a complete smash of a success with the media, with the public. There were, I believe, capacity crowds, 3,800 people a day, every day, for 110 days straight. 419,000 people saw the Clark's pictures at the Prado. And it was a great moment of pride for both institutions to pull this off, because it was not normal for the Prado to do a monographic show about a late 19th century French painter. And it was not normal for the little old Clark to be in the spotlight at the National Museum of Spain either. There you see the lines, it was kind of wonderful. And it had some ancillary interest for us too. We had actually, as we prepared our global tour, we had never done a comprehensive branded product effort. And so you just see the kinds of products that the team at the Prada put together for the show. It was marvelous, we learned a lot. And we had a great experience. Now, there were other exchanges to be had along the way. And one of the great ones was leveraging our research program appropriately in the summertime to allow for our colleagues to get their research done. So Javier Barón, who many of you met, I think, in the summer of 2010, prepared a major study of how the representation of Spanish art to the rest of the world through world's fairs in the late 19th century came to be. It was a kind of project the kind of research that couldn't have been done efficiently in Madrid. A few years later, Andrés Úbeda came and completed his magisterial corpus of all the paintings of Luca Giordano at the Prado, which I believe number something around 160. I mean, it's no. Only 120 paintings by Luca Giordano. But again, it was a pleasure to have Andres here, and I know that he desperately needed that time over the summer to pull the manuscript through completion. And more recently, the summer that we opened this building, our great colleague Gabriele Finaldi, who's now the director of the National Gallery of London, came here to complete his last project for the Prado, a monograph on Giuseppe Ribera as a draftsman, which I understand will be not only published as a book this autumn, but turned into a marvelous show at the Prado. So to return to our timeline, the Clark thought, as I mentioned, that it would embark on a global presentation of its collections. And I'll actually show you a slide I showed our trustees in November of 2010, just a month into the Renoir show. We had opened, in the span of 4 days, the major show that many of you saw here, Picasso Looks at Degas, with our partner institution, the Museo Picasso in Barcelona, followed 4 days later by Passion pour Renoir. And in January of 2011, Vicky Saltzman, who's in here somewhere, along with Richard and I, launched the announcement of the European swing of our masterpiece tour from the Hotel Ritz directly across the street from the Prado. And I have to say, it was the most generous backdrop to have. You know, we're doing this global tour, but you already know us, European Press Corps, because of the show across the street. And indeed, we did kick off that tour as we dug a big hole over here. At one point, I was going to show you pictures of the demolition of the wall house, or of the Cocker House, which now you drive through on the way into campus. But the truth is, there was plenty of work to be done on the show as well, although it was a slow cooker. The big themes that needed to be navigated included this paradox of the defender of the faith also being the man writing back and forth with Titian. Titian writes him a letter, which we quote in the catalog. He says, I hope you enjoy the one Venus. I'm going to send you another one soon from the other side. And that's how we know which picture it was. For your little room, for your Camerino. This whole idea of the sala reservata being embedded in the actual epistolary between Titian and Philip II. How to do a nude show in America. We struggled, and actually the first draft of the introduction to the catalog, I tried to tackle this idea of how here in the States, we've always been mistrustful of art, and we've always been fascinated, but also mistrustful of the human form. And you think about Horatio Greenough and that silly marble portrait a la Phidias of George Washington, and how it got thrown out of the statuary hall in the Capitol soon after it was unveiled. So how could we do that in a provocative way today? How could we, at the distance of 60 years from Kenneth Clark's essay, The Nude, which was the subject of the Mellon Lectures at the National Gallery of Art in 1953, probably a book that you read in college. It's now in its 17th edition. But how could this show actually challenge a lot of the, shall we say, loose intellectual history that may have existed in Lord Clark's groundbreaking book? And then, of course, there's the matter of which pictures, on what schedule, with what curators pulling the levers. But really, our goal was to create a show at grand scale, Baroque and Renaissance paintings that heretofore you would never have imagined could possibly be in Williamstown, paintings of a scale that could never logistically have been presented here in Williamstown. And then we moved into execution. And there were all kinds of things to consider, including the construction schedule of this building and the truth that in our inaugural summer, we wanted to present our new exhibition rooms without a lot of partition walls and with the architectural white paint. And you simply could not have done this show justice on white walls, nor could you have done Mr. Rondo's masterpiece justice that first year, probably with an old master show. And so we ended up moving the opening date from 2014 to today. There was a lot of discussion about getting the right catalog together. And as Kathy mentioned, Jill Burke, our colleague in Edinburgh, has really been doing the most exciting primary research on the role of the human body in the Renaissance imagination, as well as in Renaissance cultural history. So having her write something that might correct or at least realign our focus when we think about paintings of the nude, particularly in the Renaissance and Baroque in early modern Europe, we needed help with that. We decided on having an ensemble cast of authors, including our colleagues at the Prado, who were most generous with their catalog entries, and then other colleagues, voices from the field, including Larry Silver, our great friend and past fellow in the research program who's at the University of Pennsylvania. And then there's the actual evolving of the team, which perhaps Laura will talk about too. Getting a great book designer in Daphne Geismar from New Haven, getting our old friend Dan Wallace, formerly of the Baseball Hall of Fame, to be our designer. And all the complications of getting the curatorial voice right together as a group. And so today, if we were to check back in with those two institutions, Miguel might be enjoying the break from the madding crowds and the crush of people as the Prado has pulled off the most fabulous show about Hieronymus Bosch ever to be mounted. A truly daunting task. And here in Williamstown, we celebrate this marvelous show downstairs. But I'm going to pass it over to Miguel because he's going to get you closer to the history and the art history behind the show.
Thank you. Well, once you know about the background of this exhibition, let me say a few things about not about the specifically about the exhibition, since Laura is probably the right person to do that, and she will do afterwards, but about the context, about the collecting of erotic paintings in Spain in the 16th and 17th century. And it's important to remind these because, you know, with the exception of one painting, all these paintings, including the exhibition, were already in Madrid by 1650. And, well, this is an exhibition about the largest collection of nude paintings in Western art, about the collectors who made them, who made it, and the artists who did the paintings, and the way how these paintings were displayed in the different royal residences. I think that the most surprising fact about this and about this collection, and it has been already mentioned, this paradox, is that this impressive collection of erotic paintings was not in the very liberal Amsterdam or in Florence, but in Madrid. And the owners of this collection were the most Catholic kings in the world, the Spanish Habsburgs. These paintings were owned by the kings of Spain, a country. A country whose painters didn't practice this kind of painting. They didn't do it first because they didn't know how to do. Their education, their training was a very repetitive one. They were training in copying former models, but they didn't have access to live models. And without these live models, it's quite difficult to, you know, get a good rendition of, you know, the flesh and a naked body, but also because they were under surveillance of the Inquisition. The church was not happy with this kind of erotic paintings. They allowed the king to enjoy them because he was the king and they couldn't go against him, but they went against the artists. So as a result of that, the paintings included in this exhibition were done not by Spaniards, but mostly by Flemish and Italian artists. Actually, I'm showing you the only two surviving Renaissance Spanish paintings that include or erotic or with include nudes. And one of them, the one by Gregorio Martinez, the Punishment of Tissues, was found. Barely 3 years ago. It was totally unknown, and it was thought to be by an Italian painter, while the other, it's a unicum, it's something quite unusual. So this is that was the situation in Spain. So how did these paintings arrive into Spain? And, well, we have to say that the how, you know, by the end of the 16th century in Madrid, there were the largest collections of mythological paintings in Europe, including masterpieces such as the ones that you can see in the screens. Well, we have to say that the nude paintings play a key role in the royal collection since its beginning. The starting point was the relationship between Titian, the Venetian painter, and the Spanish Habsburgs. First, Charles V, Emperor Charles V, and then his son, Philip II. Charles and Titian met twice in Bologna, first in 1529, second in 1532, and after the second meeting, you know, Titian was appointed court painter. And he imitating what, you know, Alexander the Great had done with Apelles, Charles gave Titian the exclusivity over his portrait. Only, you know, Titian could portray Charles. For 15 years, however, Charles didn't show any interest on Titian. He was not an art lover, and so he appointed Titian as his court painter in a propagandistic movement, but not because he was a sincere lover of art. You could see through the documentation how Titian was very frustrated with this situation. Every ruler in Europe was desperately looking after him, seeking for his works, and Charles, who could ask him for whatever he wanted, he didn't pay him any attention. So Titian developed a strategy in order to catch the attention of the Emperor Charles V. And that strategy was to show that he was a very versatile artist. Charles was only interested in Titian as a portrait painter. So Titian thought that he had to show Charles that he was as good in other genres as he was in portrait painting. So when finally he had the chance to meet Charles again, that was in Augsburg in 1548, he arrived in this German city with two paintings. A religious one was an Ecce Homo, painted on a slate, that it's today at the Museo del Prado, and a Venus. That Venus, I think that it can be identified with a Venus and the mirror. The original one has disappeared, but we know how it looked like through a copy by Rubens, and this connects us with Rubens' copies after Titian, one of which is in the exhibition. So shortly after, it doesn't seem that Charles liked this kind of paintings, but his son, Philip, did. Shortly after, Titian gave to Philip a openly erotic painting. It's Mars and Venus. That painting, Mars and Venus, is lost, but we more or less could know how it looked like through this version that is at the Kunsthistorisches Museum. That was the beginning of one of the most fruitful relationships between a painter and a patron in Western history, that between Titian and Philip II. And one of the many outcomes of that relationship was what is probably the most influential set of mythological paintings in Western history, the so-called Poesie. Here you have the six paintings that Titian, whose self-portrait you can see at the left of the screen, did for Philip II, who is the figure at your right. These paintings were the ones that, you know, are referred in the letter that Tom has mentioned before about, you know, these naked women that was seen from one side or the other side. And, you know, as I was saying, this was by far the most influential set of mythological paintings ever done. These paintings were the result of this, you know, relationship between the painter and the king. The painter Titian did many, you know, mythological erotic paintings before, but Philip was truly interested on this subject. He, for instance, owned three copies of the Ovid Metamorphoses, so he was well aware of this kind of stuff. And for most of his life, he enjoyed this kind of paintings very much. We don't know exactly when, but more or less at the same time, at the end of the decade of the 40s or the beginning of the decade of the 1550s, an important gift arrived into the Spanish court. The other wonderful set of erotic paintings, in this case, the so-called Loves of Jupiter, that was done by Correggio. It was owned by Federico Gonzaga, Duke of Mantua, and he gave, we don't know exactly if he gave to Charles V or if he gave to Philip II. Anyway, these paintings, along Titian's paintings, were in Madrid by the middle of the 16th century. We know that, you know, as I said before, Philip, when he was young, until his 40s, 50s, he loved this kind of paintings. And as a result of that, when he settled the court in Madrid, in the palaces he built, he decorated them with scenes taken from the mythology, as you can see in one of the very few surviving parts of the Palacio del Pardo that include this decoration, no? With done by a Spanish painter, one of the few Spanish painters who were able to practice this kind of paintings, because he had been study in Italy. He had been trained in Italy, whose name was Gaspar Becerra. Also in the Pardo Palace was one of the most famous erotic paintings by Titian, the so-called Pardo Venus, that is now at the Musée du Louvre in Paris, and that it was a gift given by Philip IV to Prince Charles of Wales when he visited Madrid in the 1620s. So one of the interesting things that I would like to say about Philip is that for most of his life, he liked this kind of paintings, and that he knew perfectly that these paintings should be shown in a proper space. He, of course, didn't pretend to display these paintings at the Escorial, that was a religious building, but in palaces where he retired, where he could have a more private, you know, life, as it happened with the palace of the Pardo, that it was a hunting pavilion outside of Madrid, or in Madrid in the Alcázar, that it was, you know, the most important palace, but in a reserved space, the so-called vaults of Titian, after the painter, because most of the paintings were by him. This space was close to the garden, and what he was doing was following the model established by Francis I of France at Fontainebleau. Well, the other, you know, great collector of this kind of paintings was Philip IV, his grandson. And he was, you know, the largest collector of painting in Europe in the 17th century, and the model for many other rulers, including, you know, Louis XIV of France. Again, we have to face this paradoxical situation. Few Spanish painters were able to do this kind of nudes, mythological paintings. The few who did were those who had been in Italy or who had learned from the mythological paintings that were already in the Spanish royal collection, such as Velázquez and Alonso Cano. You can see a drawing by Alonso Cano, probably related with a lost painting, maybe a Danae, while the other is the very famous Rockaby Venus by Velázquez. But again, are the exceptions and by no means the rule among the Spanish painters. During the reign of Philip IV, arrived into Spain many more mythological paintings, some of them done during the Renaissance, others done by contemporary artists. Among the first, you know, probably the most important ones were the Bacchanal of the Andrians in the up left and the Worship of Venus in the low right. They were part of the very famous Camerino de Alabastro, that was an space decorated with paintings by Titian that he did in the late 1510s and early 1520s for Alfonso di Este, and that were, again, one of the most important mythological ensembles in Renaissance art. These paintings were taken to Rome, where they had a deep impact in many painters, among others, Poussin, who is also represented in the exhibition, and the paintings were given to the King of Spain. It's important how many of the paintings included in the exhibition and the paintings that were part of these collections were not bought or commissioned by the kings, but they were given to the kings as gifts, as diplomatic gifts. This is a moment when Spain was the most important power in in Europe, particularly in Italy, and every, you know, ruler in Italy tried to please the Spanish king, and they did so many times through works of art. So that's the explanation for the arrival into Spain of many of these paintings. The other source of these paintings is the figure of Rubens. Rubens, as is well known, was a Belgian painter. He was born and he lived most of his life in Antwerp, but he was the subject of the King of Spain. That part of the Low Countries were part of the Spanish Empire. So that explains the relationship, the very fruitful relationship that it was established between the Philip IV and the painter. He got many paintings, he commissioned many paintings to him, but he bought many paintings by Rubens from his estate. Once he died in 1640, his properties went on auction, and Philip bought several of these works of art, among those the ones that I'm showing you, and two of the paintings in the exhibition were or belong or were done by Rubens for himself and were part of his private collection. But of course, he commissioned many others, commissioned many others for the famous Torre de la Parada. Philip IV spent a lot of money buying, acquiring collections throughout Europe. One of the most important ones was the collection of the Marquis, the Italian Milanese Marquis Serra da Cassiano. A result of that acquisition, two of the most iconic new paintings of 17th century Italian Baroque arrived into Spain, Ipomenes and Atalanta by Guido Reni, and Venus and Adonis by Annibale Carracci. The third painting included in this image is Lot and His Daughters by Furini that is in the exhibition, and that again, it was a gift to the king, in this case, from the Duke of Tuscany. And again, you know, Philip IV followed what his grandfather had done, and he had these paintings confined in very specific places, in these palaces nearby Madrid, including the very famous Torre de la Parada, for which, you know, Velázquez did these portraits, and Titian some of the paintings included in this exhibition. And with Philip IV ends this story, his successor and his son and the last of the Habsburgs, Charles II, didn't buy paintings, mythologicals, or any other genre, neither did the Bourbons during the 18th century. My last remark is about, you know, the fact that these paintings, what makes them quite interesting is the fact not that they include naked figures or they are nudes, but they were considered erotic paintings. And it's important to remind that what makes a painting erotic or not erotic, it's not just the intention of the painter, but also relies on the eyes of the beholder. With which eyes do you look at these paintings? And I am going to finish with this example. You have in the screen at your left the Adam and Eve by Titian. This is a painting that we know that was given, again, as a diplomatic gift, not to the king, but to his Secretary of State, Antonio Pérez, Philip's the second Secretary of State. We know that the Venetian ambassador in Madrid wrote to the authorities of Venice saying, you know, if we want to please this guy who is extremely powerful, let's, you know, give him a couple of paintings by Titian. So the authorities decided, okay, so they commissioned someone to go to Titian's workshop and say, you know, choose one painting of devotion, a very devout religious painting, and a Bella Historia, a beautiful painting. We know that the very devout painting was an Entombment of Christ, that it's at the Prado, and the beautiful painting was the Adam and Eve. That means that for the Venetian authorities, this was a painting that, although it depicts a religious subject, it was a beautiful painting, it was a painting that it might be cataloged as an erotic painting. And we know that Gonzalo Pérez had this painting or thought about this painting in that way because he had this painting along all the other mythological paintings, Venus and Adonis, Danae. For him was another, you know, erotic painting. However, after his fall in disgrace, you know, Philip bought the painting and he looked at the painting with completely different eyes. He displayed it in his private chapel at the Alcázar of Madrid. So the very same painting had two completely different meanings for two different persons. Moreover, 30 years ago, the painting left the chapel at the Alcázar and was displayed in the so-called Hall of Mirrors. That was the most emblematic space in the Alcázar, you know, along the equestrian portraits of Charles V and Philip IV. We don't know exactly what happened there, but a few years later, the painting is again in a reserved space, in this case, in the vaults of Titian, along all the erotic paintings. What I'm trying to say is how the very same painting in 30, 40 years had very different meanings for those who look at them. And it's important to keep this idea in mind when we look at the paintings downstairs. Thank you.
So this is a fascinating and complex story and history. And so we've had the challenge of how to tell this story and what aspects of the story and what paintings we've sought to help create that narrative. And this is a story about the passion of collecting sophisticated patrons and collectors who had a great deal of knowledge, of taste, and interest in these paintings. And one of the works in the first gallery that you encounter, and I'll return again to it in a moment, really encapsulates the big ideas of the show. An imaginary collector's cabinet, which moves between the real and ideal, the allegorical figures of sight and smell. And this is the sense of abundance, of knowledge, of wealth, of passion that represents the main ideas that introduce the show. But you will first meet Philip II on the right and Philip IV on the left, who we've just heard a great deal about. So the idea as, you know, this is a project that I joined 9 months ago, and that we wanted to create another world, that as you're entering into the exhibition in terms of the space, in terms of the color, the experience, to really evoke not only the Sala Reservada, but the Royal Collection. And all of the paintings in the show that have been in the Royal Collections for over 400 years and now are part of the Prado, this is in fact something quite different than what we experience here at the Clark or what we've experienced here at all in the US. And so as you walk in and you have the splendor of the golden and red walls and enter into the first gallery, which really introduces you to the two main protagonists of the show, Philip IV and Philip II, and also the extent of their realm and who they were as patrons and how, in fact, the power and wealth of the Spanish Habsburgs evolved. And key to understanding that, and again, I've lost the map here, it's fill in the blanks of Europe.
Connect the dots.
Is the sense in Europe, beyond Spain, but into Northern Europe, into the Netherlands, into Italy, the extent of the Habsburg realms and beyond into the New World, and that really incredible expanse of power. But this is also a story which takes place both within and outside of Madrid. And as the exhibition both explores the role of both Philips as patrons and their private passion for collecting paintings of the nude and their taste for mythological, biblical, and allegorical paintings, and how, in fact, these, at the same time, their public and private roles as and as collectors really coalesced into the Sala Reservada. And as we explore in the show, this is not just, as you know, we've discussed already today, not just one space, one room in one palace, but actually many different rooms scattered across many different palaces. And these are just some of the main sites, both within and outside of the city, to give you a sense of the geographical landscape of what we're talking about and how wide this collection actually was displayed. And considering a Sala Reservada as beginning with the Camerino, where for Titian's mythological paintings, to Philip IV's hunting lodge, the Torre de la Parada, which we consider as a can consider as an entire Sala Reservada in its own way, as a private, reserved, privileged space where the king and only his very close associates could actually have access to. Between the two kings is Fortuna, as you enter the first gallery by Peter Paul Rubens. And it's really thrilling to have three of the canvases out of Rubens' over 60 mythological and allegorical works, which were made for the King's Hunting Lodge, the Torre de la Parada, in the 17th century. And Fortuna is one of those figures. And right away, you get a sense of the female nude, of Rubens' handling of the female figure. Full length, strong, confident, fleshy, warm female nude. The sensual qualities, the erotic qualities that were crucial to the king's taste for the nude, but also the idea how the female figure conveyed much broader, significant ideas, allegorical ideas, and larger conceits. And so she represents for us the idea of fortune, of chance, of the invariability of life's outcomes. And as she stands on a crystal ball in these ocean waves with lightning breaking in the background, stormy seas, her drapery has become her sail. She doesn't, in fact, show much hesitation at all. She's quite balanced indeed. And so as she welcomes you to the show and to the importance of the nude itself, she also really evokes the importance of the nude as a form or conveyor of knowledge and in the different ways in which the nude could operate. And if we just come back to one of the largest and really one of the most fascinating works in the show, which was done at least by four or probably more Flemish artists. And this is a work that is a collector's cabinet. And coming out of a Flemish tradition of collaboration amongst many different artists, but also the idea of wealth, of abundance, the love for painting, for sculpture, but also for knowledge. And this is a space which is imagined. The collection of works themselves are imagined, but the paintings individually are mostly all real. And they all come from different Flemish specialties, from mythological subjects to Flemish landscapes to still life. And in the foreground, the figure of sight looks at herself in the mirror. Smell is smelling a bouquet of flowers being handed to her. And so just like Fortuna, we have the sense that these very sensuous and beautifully depicted female nudes are also conveyors of allegorical or symbolic ideas. So too, though, is knowledge. Knowledge of art, knowledge of antiquity, and also knowledge of science. That in the foreground we have, in the bottom here, one of the very earliest versions of a telescope, an astrolabe, sundials, compasses across the floor and in the background, globes, porcelain from China, coral in front of the figure of sight, and this is in fact encompassing knowledge of the world in all of its different ways. And in fact, these paintings became forms of knowledge in their own right. And we can see a Judgment of Paris by Rubens, a still life by Franz Snyders, landscapes by Flemish artists, and this kind of display and some of the works, types of works that we see here in this painting, in fact, are the works that you'll then see as you continue through the galleries. So as you're introduced to the Habsburg kings and to these ideas in the first space, as you continue on then, you come to Titian, and you come to the beginning of the idea and depiction of the reclining female nude in Venice in the 16th century. Venus and Cupid reclining with a musician. And we have a sense here of, this is an enormous painting, very sensual, erotic rendering of the female form. And the story starts with Titian, the story of the nude, and the story of the patronage between Philip II and Titian. And in this very room, you see the continuation of that tradition by Tintoretto. And if you've already been downstairs, you know that this is a space which is small, which is intimate, evoking the kind of Camerino, which started the whole idea of the Sala Reservata, of this reserved space for viewing these paintings. And from this smaller space, you come into the largest gallery in the show and the enormous paintings by Peter Paul Rubens and Jakob Jordaens. And it's also in this moment where you encounter, if you have, you know, Philip II and Titian, patron and artist, and Philip IV and Rubens as the most important relationship in the 17th century, the other important story here is between Titian and Rubens, and their relationship from the 16th to the 17th century, and how Rubens looked at Titian in many different ways, and the Rape of Europa, a copy by Rubens after Titian's painting, which is in the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston, so not too far down the road, becomes a kind of wonderful moment to think about those relationships across centuries, across artistic traditions, and across the relationships between these two patrons. And this was done in 1628, when Rubens traveled on a diplomatic mission to Madrid and had the opportunity to paint and copy Titian's mythological subjects from Ovid's Metamorphoses. And this work, in fact, shows his interest and really admiration for Titian's color, his brushwork, but it also shows kind of competition, his effort to outdo Titian, and what he had achieved in sensual paintings and mythological paintings, and most of all, in the rendering of the female form. And this is a really nice moment to have Titian in the second gallery and to move into the next to look at Rubens. And I encourage you to really look at the way they've each handled the depiction of the skin and the flesh and the way they've used up the colors. And this is a wonderful way to get a sense of what Rubens was thinking, what he was working towards as he was copying Titian's paintings. He took the Rape of Europa, as well as a number of other works, back with him to Antwerp. And in 1640, as Miguel mentioned, after Rubens' death, a number of these paintings, including the Rape of Europa, were purchased and came back to Madrid to hang together. So in fact, while they had been separated, they had been created more or less side by side, they would come back together under the Habsburgs. But it's also in this space that we see the Rape of Hippodamia by Rubens and the Marriage of Peleus and Thetis by Jakob Jordaens, both after oil sketches and designs by Rubens. And these are enormous, and they're over 10 feet wide. And together they belong with the Fortuna as three of the canvases that were commissioned for the Torre de la Parada. And we have a sense here of Rubens' handling of myth, the importance of the female form, of flesh, really of sensuality here, also of paint, not only of the figures and of the story, but actually how these works were created. And so you get a sense for Rubens on a large scale and one of the most important commissions by Rubens and Philip IV. And then we would go back into a smaller space, back into something evoking that Camerino that we first encountered with Titian and Philip II, into a room of Flemish cabinet paintings. Cabinet paintings being smaller scale works, typically of landscapes with mythological or allegorical figures, done with an incredible degree of detail and intricacy, often on panel, but also copper, as this work is, a very large copper panel, which is exquisite in its color and its detail. And these types of works convey, when we go back to Sight and Smell by Jan Brueghel and others, and the Fortuna, that the female figure here is also a conveyor of allegorical ideas symbolizing something else. The figure of Ceres in the center, surrounded by water, earth, fire, and air. And it is the creatures, again, this form of knowledge of the natural world, of every seashell and fish and flower and fauna that you can imagine decorating these figures and filling the landscape. And it becomes a way in which the figure and the setting really exist in harmony together. So to think about this collection and this story of the Sala Reservada on a very large scale within a large hunting palace, but also in a much smaller smaller room, smaller scale, intimacy of relationship. And this is the story that we try to lead you through as you make your way through the exhibition. Another painting that I just wanted to spend a moment on, because it comes back to the importance of Rubens and his artistic process. This is a smaller scale relative to what you'll see of Rubens in the previous gallery, which has something of a really fascinating story. This was originally a landscape by Paul Brill, who was one of the most important Flemish landscape painters working in Rome at the end of the 16th and early 17th centuries. Brill had made this as a Saint Jerome in the landscape. And Saint Jerome was located pretty much right where we see the female figure right now. And if you look very carefully downstairs, you'll see that there's a bit of Jerome's red robe still left in the foreground. Rubens, as he was known to do, had a large art collection himself in Antwerp. He bought this painting sometime in the early decades of the 17th century, brought it back to Antwerp, kept it there, and after owning it for probably 15 or 20 years or even longer, decided to change it. And so he decided to remove Saint Jerome and to replace the penitent saint with a figure, the nude figure of Psyche and Jupiter. And a moment, a narrative moment from an ancient myth from Apuleius's The Golden Ass, of Psyche's labors, where Jupiter has taken the form of an eagle and is retrieving the cup from Psyche to retrieve water from the river beside her. But it's a moment that Rubens is, he's thinking nymphs and satyrs, which you'll see as well in the show, that he returned to it, took a 20-year break, enlarged the canvas, changed the figures, made them more sensual. And this is again what he's doing here. He's thinking about the figure, he's thinking about this movement from the sacred to the secular, and taking our saintly figure into a very soft, fleshy, voluptuous female nude. So from here, though, you'll turn away from Flemish painting, and we see Lot and His Daughters by Farini that Miguel introduced to you before, and the ways in which, in the first half of the show, it's very tightly focused on this relationship between Titian and Philip II and Rubens and Philip IV. And while that continues in different ways in the rest of the exhibition, there's an important sense of how other works entered the collection. And as Miguel mentioned, the Farini was a gift to Philip IV on his second wedding to Mariana of Austria, and who was his niece. And this was a wedding gift, a very incredibly sensual, erotic depiction of this biblical story. And you'll get a sense here, which is lost on the slides, of the blue, the lapis lazuli, just the preciousness of the materials themselves, the wonderful rendering of the fabric around Lot's daughter's waist here, the details such as the ribbon in her hair and the vase that she's holding here for the wine. But also, part of the story is, in fact, the male nude. And this is not meant to be a show that looks meant to juxtapose the male and the female nude, but of course this is an important part of telling the story as well, and the Sala Reservada. We have two wonderful images of Zubarán, the Spanish painter Zubarán's labors of Hercules, which were made for another privileged site within the realm of the Habsburgs, in the Buen Retiro Palace, the Hall of Realms. And these mythological works of Hercules were hung rather up high between the windows, below which were battle scenes of Habsburg and Spanish victories, and portraits of the royal family. And in this way, the Habsburgs were able to draw a connection, which they very much believed to draw their lineage back to Hercules himself, and that he was, in fact, the founder of the Habsburg dynasty. And so the soft, the fleshiness, what we've seen with Rubens and Titian and how these artists were handling the female form, in fact, becomes highly muscular, strong, highly articulated muscles, light and shadow of these mythological moments. And from here, you also have ancient history, Cleopatra, The Suicide of Cleopatra by Guido Reni, where subjects from the Bible and from mythology became an excuse to depict the female nude and the ways in the artists used these stories to really harness those moments. And just that this is a moment where Cleopatra has asked for, after the knowing the defeat of her armies will come, for a poisonous snake, an asp, to be hidden in a basket of fruit to surprise her. And this is the moment then, as you'll see, her skin is turning green. The blood is slowly leaving her body, seemingly or leaving her face in this way. And that moment of suffering, of impending death, also emerges in the figures of Saint Sebastian. And these are two of the religious images by Guido Reni on the left, the same artist of Cleopatra, and Ribera's Saint Sebastian on the right. And there's a third by Juan de Carreño in the exhibition as well. And this is a much more direct sense of the male nude form in a very spiritual sense of martyrdom and the importance of the saint and the importance of this moment of suffering, but also censorship. And the figure of Saint Sebastian was an opportunity to depict an idealized male torso, but it was also one which could become quite erotic and quite sensual. And in the, I think it's in the 18th century that the loin, the cloth around Sebastian's waist was extended up his midriff, so not so much of his body was exposed. So these are ideas that we can't quite imagine today, but in some way or another we have other generations of the royal family and of artists approaching these subjects, coming back to Miguel's last point of how the beholder has a, can have a very different relationship with these works and the different way the ways they were formed. And the few last points I just want to conclude with is the show, as it looks at the various palaces and the Salas Reservadas across Madrid, it also follows the arc of that tradition into the 19th century, and as was already mentioned, into the Prado's own Sala Reservada, which existed from 1827 to 1838. And along the way, from the 16th and 17th centuries into the 19th century, the Sala Reservada was not only a privileged reserved space for the display of paintings of the nude, but it also became a site of protection. That in the 18th century, under kings such as Charles III and Charles IV from the Bourbon dynasty, you have a very different attitude. They weren't quite so pleased with paintings of the nude, and they attempted to have them burned and to have them destroyed. And it was through the efforts of court painters such as Mengs, who saved these paintings by sequestering them away from the royal palace, away from the kings, in places where they wouldn't have to look at them, but in fact, it saves them from destruction. There's also a Sala Reservada in the Academy of San Fernando, where the nude becomes a way for artists to learn. So the evolution of this tradition of the Sala Reservada then culminates in the 19th century. And these are just examples of other works in the show and how they would have been displayed in a very different hang, tightly together. One wall downstairs gives you a sense of that rather than in a this room they have to breathe around them downstairs would have been quite a different experience. And no differentiation between mythological, biblical, they would have all been hung together. And the last painting that I want to leave you with, and the last idea, is in fact, again, coming back to this relationship between the beholder, the artist, viewer and viewed. And this is one of the most important works in the show of Guercino, Susanna, and the Elders, the biblical story where Susanna is bathing as she does every day in the garden, typically undisturbed. And here Guercino shows her unaware of the two elders who will spy on her, and in the next moment of the story will approach her and proposition her to sleep with them. And she will refuse. But before everything else has happened, this is the moment where we, however, know what's going on. And as the one elder gazes rather lecherously at Susanna, the other looks out at us and raises something of an admonishing finger with his face covered in shadow. And this relationship becomes one that is quite important. They are looking at us, we are looking at them, as we've been looking at the female body, who's allowed to see, who's not allowed to see. And in many ways, this we as the viewer become part of the story that we're hoping to, that you'll enjoy and share with us downstairs. So thank you. And so I think now we'll open it up for questions or comments. If anyone has any.
Thank you so much, all three of you, for really a great overview of the show. I have a question for Miguel. And I was thinking about this as we were thinking about the passion of these two particular kings, Philip II and Philip IV, as collectors. But also thinking about how these paintings come in and out of the collections. They come in sometimes as diplomatic gifts. Sometimes they go out as diplomatic gifts. So that, for example, the Titian's Rape of Europa is now in the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. I'm wondering if you can talk just a moment about the role that court painters such as Velázquez had on actually what came in and out of the collection. To what extent were the kings really dictating every aspect of the formation of these collections, and to what extent were other agents involved?
Well, it all depends on the kings. Some of them had their own opinion about art and the way how they should be displayed, and the artists they like it, and the genres they prefer, such as the case of Philip II and Philip IV, while others, Philip III or Charles II, didn't care about paintings. So obviously when the king had strong opinions, the court painter had less to do. When the situation was the opposite, the king had a very active, the court painter had a very active role. There is somehow an exception with the figure of Velázquez, but Velázquez was the court painter for almost 35, 40 years. And it's not the same, the Velázquez when he arrived from Seville, who was not familiar with the royal collection, and Velázquez at the end of his life when he has all the control over the collection, not just as court painter, but he was also he was appointed like the officer of the palace. So it was not a position reserved for artists. He was in fact the first artist who held this. But he had the control over the Alcázar, and then you know it was very important also the figure of Rubens. When Rubens arrived into Spain the second time in 1628, 1629, he was the most important star in the European art scene. What Rubens said, you know, everybody, you know, accepted, and he had a very active role. We know that some of the spaces in the royal palace were redecorated during or immediately after Rubens' sojourn in Madrid, because probably he gave suggestions. He told the king that I like this or I like that. He was the one who took Velázquez to the Escorial and who told him, you want to go to Italy, first study the amazing collection of Titians that you have here. And that changed forever the way Velázquez understood and practiced the painting. So it depends, but you know, the artists, of course, and then some of these artists were also dealers, or they could act as agents. For instance, the second time that Velázquez went to Italy, he went because just for buying paintings for the royal palace. Of course, that he had very clear indications from the king, which were the artists he was interested on, but he also had some freedom for choosing the artists and the paintings that he thought that could be better for the king. So yeah, they had many, many, many roles, and sometimes they were decisive in the development of the collections.
Thank you so much for just a beautiful exhibition. I was very curious, how do we know the Paul Breel had been altered by Rubens?
I'll take that one.
Well, it's marvelous. About 20 years ago, the Prado took an x-ray, and they found this figure beneath, and scholars struggled with this for a little while, but then someone knew that the Paul Breel, St. Jerome in a Landscape, had been made into a print in 1625. So it was a combination of both art history and technical inquiry that revealed that, the painting, which had been cataloged in the Sala Reservata, actually under a third artist's name, that it could actually securely be attributed to Breel and be a painting from 1604, but then also have been a painting that was essentially mutilated, but in a very aesthetically pleasing way, by Rubens sometime in the last two decades of his life. Oh, no. No, he actually invented some of the trees. You'll see there's two different characters of trees in the picture, and some of them are Rubens trees, and some of them are Breel trees.
I mean, it's in his inventory. It's in his sale as a Jupiter and Psyche by him.
Rubens also had less so with paintings, more so with drawings. That he collects as a huge collector of drawings and paintings and sculpture. He would alter drawings by Italian Renaissance masters himself to improve upon them. So this was also within his own artistic practice, things he would do.
Enjoy the show.